All right, let me try a recording on direct to YouTube because Ustream is not working right now for some reason. Technology always, you never know what's gonna when it's going to work, when it will stop working, etc. The situation in the world is about to become really, really, really weird. The Olympics will kick it off. It's gonna become so weird that we need to truly find stability. A stability that is not bothered by any amount of weirdness at all. In other words, a stability where no weirdness, imaginable or unimaginable, can affect that stability. Is there such a stability? There is. There is. There are some teachers who are talking about that. What we do here on Christ Clarity Satsang is to inquire into why are we so reluctant to choose that. Most teachers just try to encourage us to choose it, and they don't clarify why we're so reluctant. They just kind of say, just you know, close your eyes, relax, go into this and go beyond this and that, kind of that sort of thing. And what we do here is we point out, you know, where's our reluctance really coming from? If we can see that, if we can see that, we should be able to move into perfect stability. Okay. So we need to go over to look at this. That's what we do here. Why are we avoiding stability? Because stability is literally more important than breath, than breathing. It will be coming up. It will be all important to have this inner stability. It's not an intellectual stability. It doesn't come from an intellectual academic grasp of stability, of the concept of stability, or even a grasp of what the problem is. It comes from actually abiding in stability because stability is abidance. It is not an experience or a experience. It is not a realization or a recognition. Or it's not an object, it's not something that we are experiencing. Okay, it is an abidance within stability itself. There's a difference. We have to trace our confusion back to the very beginning. Because the problem that we're having now is exactly the same problem that it's always been. Because cause and effect do not separate from one another. So if there is something's causing a problem for us, it's the exact same cause as it's always been. Same problem, same cause, and there is a problem that we're having. Very much so. We are trying to be prime creator. We are trying to be greater than God. What is God? God is identity. Identity is present always. Always has been, always will be. It is prime. Okay, there's nothing prior to identity. What we're trying to do to be greater than identity, greater than God, we're trying to be prior to God, prior to identity. We're trying to experience identity. Now, if identity is being experienced, isn't there then an experiencer that's doing the experiencing? And therefore, that one would be prior to identity. So you see, our desire to be prime creator is what is causing the problem for us. We want to have identity as an experience that something else other than identity is experiencing identity. And that is impossible. You cannot turn identity into an experience. You cannot turn it into a recognition or a realization. We cannot realize identity because who is doing the realizing would be the question, right? We presume there is this something, this I, that is capable of have realizing identity, of experiencing identity. That's the delusion. There is no such I to experience identity. Identity cannot be experienced by anything. That is why we say we just abide in it. We're not, it's not us abiding in identity. It is identity abiding in itself. It is not a person experiencing identity. It is not an I experiencing identity. It is identity simply being identity. Abiding in it. Okay, this is the crucial differentiation, the crucial distinction. And it is all important to at least poke around here and look at this. Because it's the difference between stability and instability. And the weirdness of the world. If it's not weird enough already. I stayed in the house for a couple of days over the weekend. And then a Sunday night, I went out to Trader Joe's. And I just, you know, getting some stuff, some food. I looked at everybody, and everybody looked so weird. You know, it's like, wow. Everybody's very unique, and everyone's a little bit off kilter. You know, very weird. Weirdness rules right now in the world. And it's always ruled here, but never more so than now. And it's almost like you have to go out every single day just to assume that everything is normal. I mean, there's no weirdness. But if you stay, if you isolate yourself for a while from the world, and then you go back out, guaranteed you will feel, oh my gosh, the world is really, really weird. Really weird. And it is. But it's just, it's going to absolutely flower. This weirdness is going to flower to incredible extent very soon. And let's see if this video, if it gets past the 7.5 minute mark. If it does, maybe this will work. If not, you know, you won't be hearing this. So all efforts to look at this central problem we have, it is truly central, completely central. We are trying to have an experience of identity, which is impossible. Because having an experience somehow means there's something other than identity experiencing it. And it also implies that having an experience is not something that is prime and eternal and endless, right? Whereas abiding, identity simply abiding as identity, that does have a timeless feel to it, doesn't it? And it doesn't mean that there's something else experiencing it. This is the crucial area of investigation, of inquiry that we have to make. And we have to keep clarifying it here. Keep clarifying it. It's not wasted effort at all. And just because we, you know, don't get it, again, who is it that's supposed to get it? Does identity need to get something? Does identity need to recognize something? Does identity need to realize something? Does it need to understand something? Does it need to grasp something? What is it? Does identity really need to do anything other than simply abide as what it is? As it is. You might say, as it is. As it is. So, we are continuing to struggle with trying to have this experience of identity and believing that there's some power that will enable this to take place. And we're trying to find ways to release this power. Otherwise, we'd give up. The only way we can continue on trying to have an experience of identity is the belief in there's some power, some magical power that will enable us to take place. And therefore, we turn towards the weirdness. The weirdness in the world is literally how we keep trying to release this power so we can experience identity and therefore experience at the same time being greater than identity. Okay? If we were to experience identity, we would simultaneously experience being greater than identity. And that is our goal. That is our goal. So of course why we're reluctant to abide as the self, abide as identity. what Ramana Maharshi simply said, abide as what you are, identity. Just be that. No one being that. Just identity being identity. That is the true state. That is life. That is reality. That's all. And so we're still trying to have an experience of identity. And we know that would be an experience of being greater than identity, which is what we're aiming for. And we never reach that. And the futility of it all would become apparent to us, except that we keep on believing. We have to believe in magic. Otherwise, we would have dropped this idea immediately. The only reason we did not drop this ridiculous attempt to be greater than the Prime Creator was we instantly believed in magic. Meaning that there's some power that even the Prime Creator doesn't know about. There's some greater power that has the capability to elevate us above the Prime Creator. And nobody knows where it is or where it's hiding or how it can be activated, but we just set this as the basic premise of our belief system, that it's there. And this is simply an article of faith on our part. Literally, the entire situation we're in is based on nothing but faith. Blind faith. Completely blind faith. That there is this power. And that eventually it will be released. And everything, the dance of existence, the magic show, the dance of Maya, dance of duality, play of energy, play of consciousness, all of that is literally this ridiculous mixture of ritual and weirdness, an attempt to activate this power, this new energy, something that is going to energize us in some way so that then we experience identity and therefore we are Prime Creators, Prime Creator. We say, but we're the ones that must have created identity because we are experiencing it, but then we say, well, we're not identity, and yet here we are experiencing it. We must be greater than identity. Beyond it, you know. Something other than identity is experiencing identity, which is completely impossible. And the only way we keep this is, again, complete blind faith that there's some power that can accomplish this for us. And so we leave ourselves completely open to the weirdness of existence. And believe me, and you don't have to take my word for it, because I'm sure you know that from your own experience, in moments of clarity, you realize that existence is completely bizarre, completely weird. It is like a surreal nightmare. Totally surreal. It's a bizarre blend, you know, of just so much. And the most bizarre thing of all is that we try to think of that it's all normal, that there's all, it all, some purpose to all this, that it's all organized, that it's all purposeful. You know, it's not. It's chaotic. It is aimless wandering. It is weird. And it's that way simply because we are desperately trying to throw everything possible, including the kitchen sink, as far as trying to activate this power, this magical power that will enable us to experience identity, to have identity as an experience, as a realization that we're realizing it. And nothing works. Nothing has ever worked. So we just continue to make all sorts of efforts. I mean, I look at the world and what's going on, and to me it is just totally, extremely weird. And that's just an honest appraisal. I'm not, you know, trying to sugarcoat it and say, oh yeah, this is just all normal. There's nothing. What's normal? Existence has always been weird. Just look at history. And it's this pageant. It's this pageant of weirdness. And never more so than now. I mean, it's just, things are just getting absolutely bizarre. You know, half the conspiracy theories are completely bizarre, the other half are accurate, you know, and yet in their accuracy they're pointing out to something that is completely bizarre and weird. So, you know, it's all this soup, this goulash, you know, of weirdness. So that's seen clearly. There is not the idea that all this is, there's some divine pattern. It's all working out, you know, the way it's supposed to, is nonsense. The dance of energy, play of Maya, the magic show, is all completely weird, strange, bizarre, and not understandable. Because it is literally an appeal to magic. It's as if we were standing in front of nothing and going through all sorts of gyrations, infinite gyrations, trying to get this nothing to empower us so that we can be greater than identity. And the funny thing is that there is nothing there. We've all just been acting weird. And it's not like we want to act weird. It's just that nothing works, and that makes us weird. It drives us to weirdness. We do all sorts of crazy stuff. Our lives are crazy. Everything's crazy. Our thoughts, it's all nuts. You know, this is an insane asylum. That's what my guru, Ananda Maimawa, said. This world is an insane asylum. That's how she saw it. Because we are all acting insanely, trying to activate this unseen, unknowable, mysterious, mystical, magical power that isn't there. And you know, so when any time someone is desperate to bring about a result and it doesn't happen, what do? They start getting into weirdness, right? Really. You start maybe getting up and doing a dance and doing some shouting, and then before you know it, you're tearing your rent clothes and beating your head and drinking weird stuff just whatever, you know, just let's just throw something else on the fire. It's like that. Let's just, what the heck, you know, let's do this. So, and then some other people plot weirdness, plot weird stuff ahead of time. Some are real spontaneous, other plot it. So it's a mishmash. The world is an absolute mishmash. Total mashup. Mishmash. That's what it is. We don't need to sugarcoat it. When you see the truth, when you understand what's going on, you don't need to be dishonest about it and somehow pretend that this isn't just this complete mishmash of craziness and madness and insanity for what it is. The way we behave, you know, is just too weird. But when you're in it and you're desperate, it seems like appropriate. Because you feel like, well, I gotta do something. You know, I haven't found a way yet to empower myself to experience identity, so you know, I've got to try something. And you know, I can't just try the same old thing, so let's just veer over here or do this or that, and just it never stops. It's this play of consciousness, play of Maya, of delusion. But it's not really delusion, you see. It's not like that at all. We're not deluded, okay? We are simply trying to accomplish something, and we're not able to do it. And we are simply trying so hard, so many different ways. You know, some people talk about, oh, God made existence off all this variety. There's so much diversity. No, God didn't make existence. The diversity is there because we are simply trying so many different ways. And we try this, and we try that, and then we go back to this, and we're back to that. We try all different types of systems of governance and laws and rules, all different types of people, you know. All this diversity is simply all our efforts. And you have to realize that we are spirit. We are infinitely and endlessly creative. And so we have the capacity to simply try all this stuff and keep it going. You know, we'll write 1,000,000 poems and then 1,000,000 more. We'll make 1,000,000 movies and we'll make 1,000,000 more. and we'll make a billion bodies, and we'll make a billion more. And we'll continue this dance, this crazy, weird dance. Grateful Dead said, what a long, strange trip it's been. Yeah, but what they should have said is, what a long, strange trip it will always be, existence. You know, the effort to experience identity, to realize identity as an experience, it will always be a long, strange trip. Because you can never do it. There isn't anything, any outside of identity. There is nothing outside of identity at all. So how can nothing experience identity? It cannot. It cannot. And we keep thinking there's some obstacle in the way. We have to remove the obstacle. So, you know, if we just activate it, this power, you know, the obstacles will be removed. And nobody's come up with a way to activate it yet. So we'll, you know, I mean, we try. Well, everybody will congregate and we'll do the same thing. We'll do it for thousands of years and, you know, it doesn't work. We'll do rituals. People will band together. All different things. Some think that just longevity, doing the same thing over and over, a ritual over and over, will accomplish it. And others think that doing no ritual, just constantly changing, will do it. Some think that being compulsive about it will do it. So you have all these different personality efforts. Every single person on the planet is doing some type of different effort, to some extent. And even within that difference, that some are band together in big institutions and try to do the same ritual all the time, constantly trying to accomplish it. Literally everything, all the weirdness that you have in the past, that is happening now and in the future, is all exactly the same purpose. And it's all equally futile, 100% futile. We'll never accomplish what we hope it will accomplish. Never. So you see how it's possible to detach from the weirdness, at least to the point of inquiry, saying, you know, hey, talking about different types of weirdness is not important. What's important is seeing that it's all the same. It's literally all the same. And we're not used to doing that, because we're used to, when we look at weirdness, they say, oh my gosh, it's all so weird, it's all so different. Inquiry turns that around and says, no, it's all exactly the same. It's all a frantic attempt to accomplish this, the same purpose. Everything that we see in existence is an attempt to accomplish the exact same purpose. It's just the reason why everything seems so weird and different is because nothing works. So we're just trying everything we can possibly imagine or think of or come up with or plot or, you know, arrive at, whatever. It's all has the exact same purpose, one purpose, and it's futile. So from that standpoint, it's all the same, you see. So inquiry suddenly takes you out of the weirdness and all of feeling, you know, pulled here and there by the weirdness, and thinking, you know, what should I join? What should I do? What kind of effort should I join with? And trying to figure out, you know, who are the good guys? Who are the bad guys? What should I do? And we realize it's all exactly the same. So what choice? The choice becomes different. It's to say, wait a minute, how can I let go of this effort? Because it's all exactly the same, and it's all 100% futile. So therefore, you no longer feel like driven and torn apart by trying to figure out which type of weirdness should I be part of. You don't have to be part of any of it. You can literally drop the effort to experience, to realize identity, and simply then identity abides as identity, the awareness of that. There's just an inherent, innate awareness of it. It's not someone being aware of it. It's just the presence of identity. Identity is present. That's the abidance. It's just identity does abide in identity automatically. So there is simply that. Already there. No one realizing it. Doesn't need to be realized. Is identity trying to find someone to realize identity? No. We, spirit, is trying to do that because we are free. There's a freedom in reality to experience anything. And so we thought, you know, hey, I wonder if we can be prior to identity. Certainly, you know, we cannot. There's nothing prior to identity. We cannot establish anything outside of identity to experience identity. It's impossible. So, this is the inquiry that you can feel that it's taken you out to a different place. You're no longer as vulnerable as you were when you're looking at things this way. All weirdness is attempting the exact same purpose. It's all the same. All appearances are very deceptive, right? So we have to go beyond appearances to this reason that tells us it's all exactly the same. There's no difference whatsoever. Why? It's all attempting the exact same, it has the exact same goal as its purpose. All share the exact same purpose, and all share the exact same futility. So, all differences are meaningless, right? To claim there's some difference in weirdness is meaningless and folly. And that brings about severe instability in us, because then we're trying to figure out the differences and trying to make so-called intelligent choices among the differences. We cannot do that. We cannot do it, because there is no intelligent difference between any of it. None whatsoever. All weirdness is equally weird, equally futile. And getting to this point, getting to this is so important, because it's kind of like the point where it's possible to let go, set it down, you know, which is what we're trying to do. There's some who seem to have set it down, and then they report on that to us. But they've traditionally been very, for some reason, quite lax about explaining the causation of it, which is what we're doing here. So we're kind of boosting the whole situation, boosting it, and making it crystal clear what's going on. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. So it doesn't matter how weird they are. We don't have to judge it anymore. This is what's called the final judgment, which precedes the final judgment. After that is made, then no more madness, you know, no more weirdness, because you've left it behind, because you've seen that it's all exactly the same. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. So there's a complete sameness to it, and you don't have to continue to try to interpret what you're seeing perceptually as somehow different. And that should bring a massive relief to us, massive stability to us, as we slip behind the veil, as it were, of falsity and illusion and insanity, really. Insanity is a better way of putting it. But it's even beyond that. Futility is a better way to put it. Slip beyond the veil of futility. We, in our desperate effort to succeed, we don't recognize the futility of it. And we keep thinking there are differences where there are none. There are none. There are no differences in existence. None. And there don't need to be, does there? Because why do we need to believe the impossible can be accomplished? As if some path is somehow more successful in activating a non-existent power that is never there to be activated. Is some way, some weirdness going to be more effective in that? No. It's zero effectiveness, because there is no such power. So there'll never be such a power released, and we're literally talking to nothing. We're appealing to nothing. We're doing our song and dance in front of nothing. We think there's some judge there. And if we just do the right song and dance, the judge is going to say, okay, I am now going to give you the experience of identity. That nothing, that nothingness that isn't there, we often think of that in our desperate effort to succeed. We think that's God, that God is somehow hidden and mysterious. And we pray to this God. We're trying to do our song and dance for this imaginary God, thinking that at some point it will please this God and it will release this power for us. No, identity is God. It's the identity that we're trying to experience as if we're greater than it. That identity is God. Identity is life. Life is identity. No such thing as life without identity. No such thing as identity without life. They're one and the same. Prime. That's the prime. Primary. That's God. The prime creator is identity. It's endless. Without end. Boundless. One identity. Just identity. The present. Presence. That is identity. That is God. What we're doing is we're gyrating and foaming at the mouth and shouting and gesturing and talking gibberish to nothing and believing that we're actually doing all this for some God and that we'll find a way eventually for God to have mercy on us and release this power that will empower us to turn identity into experience that we're having. This is completely delusional. It is simply a vain hope, a false hope that we have to have in order to even pursue this notion of trying to be prime creator. We have to have a vain hope. We have to believe that there is some source that we can get. We can, some source that has this power. And that this power can be released and will enable us to have identity as something we experience. And so, of course, we are praying to this power. We are worshiping it. We are hoping. We are, you know, everything we do, whether we claim, you know, whether this power we think of it, we call it God, or we call it nothing, or life, or evolution, or intelligent design, any of that stuff, same thing. It's still are trying to appeal to something. Even if we don't admit it. But many are very open about it and blatant, just saying, hey, God, you know, help us out. You know, we say, well, God is, you know, mysterious. He's hidden. God's hidden. He works in mysterious ways, has some mysterious powers, and has not yet released the ultimate power, but we're almost there. If we all just get together in groups and be unified, That unity, then that being unified as unity will enable us to will activate this power. God's just waiting for us to do that. This is all a narrative of false hope. And the weirdness, is there any, I mean, weirdness is all weird, right? And one of the types of weirdness is attempt to unify the world. That's going to get really weird because that's what's coming up. That's going to be so weird what's happened. Just bizarro. Totally crazy stuff. The idea that we just unify the world and we all have exact same appeal, you know, and everybody makes a unifying prayer to this imaginary non-existent nothingness that we think has some kind of power that will, we can activate this power for us. We're going to, you know, go that route. That's the route that is we're headed towards, along with all sorts of ancillary weirdness too, which is will spin off in innumerable directions. And the world is about ready to become extremely weird. It always is extremely weird, but again, never more so than what's coming up. And so, you know, we don't want to get caught up in that weirdness. I don't like weirdness. Never have. Never have. Even though I lived through the 60s, you know, I didn't like it. I really didn't like it. And of course the 50s are really weird too in their own way, very weird. If you go back there and look at the commercials and everything, I mean, it was really really weird. But the 60s, you know, were maybe outdid the weirdness for sure. And then the 70s came along, and that was extremely weird too. And then the 80s and 90s, you know, all of it totally weird. But coming up now, it's just going to, you know, be icing on the cake, what's going to happen. And again, our purpose is to see it all exactly the same. It's completely flat. But no need to judge it except make one judgment. And as I say, it's all equally futile. And then set it down. Because what are you setting down? Nothing. What's being set down, really? All we're doing is realizing that nothing is nothing. And that no power is no power. That's all. It's not like we have to say, well, there is a God, there is a power, but we're never going to be able to activate that power. No, that's not what we're saying. We're saying there is no imaginary God of nothing that's in hiding. There is no power to enable us to be experiencers of identity. No such God, no such power. Never has been, never will be. It's just simply nothingness, nothing at all that we've been pretending, hoping was something that had some power. Just hoping. So we're not really setting anything down. We're not losing anything. There's no loss at all. What are we losing? There never was any power there. So we have to keep harping on this. Keep harping on it because it's truth. And the thing is, it is to have some pivotal turning within of accepting, yeah, this is true. And there's an acceptance that has to take place. A few have had this acceptance take place in them, apparently. Somehow. Some acceptance took place within them. And they realize this is all futile. It's all equally futile. So what am I doing? I need to set it all down. All is one. Because I'm not setting down anything. The idea that somehow we have to have some massive dropping away or divesting of something is ridiculous, because it's like setting down zero. There's really not even any setting down that takes place. Maybe we're waiting for some dramatic setting down, you know, and actually we're setting down zero. So really, we really can't even experience the setting down, as it were. We can experience like the last judgment is just saying, hey, this is all nothing. What we've been doing is just nothing. We haven't been doing anything. And that's the problem with existence, is it is inherently weird. And setting it down, and so we see it all as just one, all flat, then somehow that enables us to simply be completely unconcerned about the weirdness. And then it's no longer bothering us at all. But it's still weird. Completely weird. I know there are some who claim that it's all moving with this perfect precision and intelligent design and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I don't buy that. You know, I could be wrong from some standpoint. You know, like accidental meetings always mean something, but no, actually, that's all still weird, because we're hoping that these accidental meetings and these coincidental meetings, all these experiences we're having, we're still hoping that that's going to cause this power to be released. It's as if we're saying, hey, you know, grace, God's grace is working in the world, and that means there is this power, and it is going to be released. There is this God that we can't discern or find anywhere, and it's hidden from us, and yet we can feel this power, you know, moving in existence and ordering things and causing stuff to happen, and so we can be all, you know, hopeful that something will happen, you know, but that's all delusional. Identity doesn't have to work that way. Identity simply reminds us that, you know, of our folly. That's all I've experienced. I've experienced both. I've experienced inquiry and being reminded of the truth, and I've experienced all sorts of this external experiences and grace, etc. But I have to tell you that those external experiences that all felt so coordinated and, you know, serendipitous, etc., etc., I don't think they ever led to anything at all. It only produced false hope. Only produced false hope in me. That's what it did. So there is this power that we have of networking and having experiences and noticing things. There is that. I can literally cause it to happen. If I truly pray hard enough for that to happen, all sorts of coincidence starts happening. But I realize I'm the one who is bringing them about. Traditionally, we've said, no, God's grace is bringing all this about. I have found that that is not so. That it's actually, we're the ones who are causing all these extremely amazing coincidences to take place. And we're thinking, oh my gosh, I'm being guided. I mean, I've been through this. I received guidance that was simply unbelievable. But it never led to anything. It was just a dead end. And I looking at it for a long time now, I've been able to see I was the one generating all of this. All the synchronicity, I was the one generating it. Just so that I could have hope, false hope. Amazing, amazing, amazing. And then when I stopped trying to generate, it stopped. It stopped. And I thought, oh my gosh, God, why have you forsaken me? And literally, I had that experience. I feel like God's forsaken me, that the gurus have forsaken me, all this stuff, because I'm no longer generating all that plausible hope, like that they're active in my life and doing stuff and God is guiding me, all this kind of stuff. It's not true. I'm trying to guide myself. Our own intelligence of spirit is doing this guidance, but it's all an attempt to generate false hope that there is this power that will enable us to have identity as an experience that we're having. No, identity itself is God. Identity doesn't need some external experiencer of identity. It simply is what it is. It doesn't need to be ordering existence in any way. It is not concerned with existence. It is not concerned with the weirdness. At all. It means nothing. I think maybe the Prime Creator might be a little amused, perhaps a little amused, that the Spirit is standing there and acting completely bizarrely and weirdly, trying to propitiate some non-existent, unreal nothing, nothingness, you know. There must be some humor and bemusement in that. Prime Creator does have a sense of humor, really. We have that innate laughter. And there's probably nothing funnier than all the acting out that we're doing. This whole drama that we've spun out. You know, all this weirdness. We don't need any guidance, the kind of guidance we think that we're getting from God. No, the reason is within us. Reason can simply inquire into the situation and just inform us this is what's going on. And we say, oh, if we see what's going on, it's very easy, very simple. So what kind of guidance do we need? For what? We just make the last judgment. See, all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. And, you know, wash our hands of it. Stop trying to appeal to nothing. Stop praying to nothing. Just let it go. Has never accomplished anything, never will. We don't need to keep being these sheep, you know, these weird sheep that are, I mean, just the whole thing. Existence is completely weird. Animals are weird. People are weird. Plants are weird. Planets are weird. Everything here is completely weird. Makes no sense whatsoever. I have to say, I don't have the slightest idea of what this is all here, except I know that it's all here simply as an attempt to accomplish the impossible, which is meaningless. I've always had that feeling like, I look at everything, I say, I have zero understanding of anything I'm looking at. None. I have no idea what any of this is for, so to speak. makes no sense, it's not understandable, it's completely weird. Completely weird. I've always had that feeling. And the fact is, that's true. That's a true feeling. That's the feeling that is right, that is speaking for truth. The world is not understandable. What is there to understand other than futility? And what is there to understand in futility? Nothing. So, and I'm saying this, all of this, because it's so vitally important, because weirdness is about to spin off in so many directions and become so intense. Yuck. I mean, I can see it. It makes you shudder. Horrible. I don't like it. Anyone who doesn't like weirdness, you know, is going to hate the future. Really. Really, really, really. I don't even like going over to Santa Cruz. Because, you know, the motto of Santa Cruz is keep Santa Cruz weird. Santa Cruz is a very weird place. Very weird. I don't like it at all. So I don't like weirdness. Really don't. You know, those, there's some places that celebrate weirdness. Like, that's one of those places. And Berkeley. Also, I don't like Berkeley. I don't like places that celebrate weirdness. Can't stand them. Because it's just really celebrating insanity. And in a suffering. Really, it's profound suffering. There's nothing fun about it whatsoever. We're entitled to perfect peace. We're entitled to the unimaginably rich experience of multidimensionality as identity expands itself. Expands. The one identity expands, and that infinite, endless expansion. We're entitled to be that. You know, we are that. And we are literally trying to separate from that. And that is not funny. It's not funny. It's not fun. It's sick. It's sad. It's misery. It's suffering. It's fear. It's horrible. It's a nightmare. And to simply, you know, try to beat some drums and chant and go in a circle and celebrate weirdness is absolutely verklempt, crazy, bizarre. Don't want any part of it. You know, it's just, it's like a gesture of futility, you know, like, hey, let's just make this gesture to some unseen God. Let's make this crazy gesture. Let's all do this. And you know it's futile. If you know it's completely futile, then why do it? Why exhaust yourself? Why go through that generating a false hope and delay and forget it. So the future holds zero appeal to me. Zero. Absolutely none. It's simply a continuation of weirdness. It's like weirdness on steroids. Literally. It's like weirdness on drugs. Literally. It's like weirdness gone berserk. Literally. It's like Pandora's box. The gates of hell, the gates of weirdness are suddenly breached, you know, opened. Flood. A tsunami of weirdness is coming. And there are many here that you know, really dig that weirdness. You know, it's like they say, oh man, we can't wait to get into it. Can't wait. Let's get into really, really extreme weirdness, and that should work for us. You know, we're gonna find ourselves by doing that. No, you don't find yourself that way. You find yourself by calm, careful, reasoned inquiry and looking and seeing the truth. Reason knows the truth, it just tells you. And you realize all of this is equally futile. That's zero. It's nothing there. There is no power. We're appealing to a power which isn't there. It has no cause, no basis to be there. It's simply a fantasy, a belief, a hope, a wish that we have. Total wishful thinking. That's all we're doing. With no zero substance to it. Zero. That's it. That's all we're doing. And that's very tiresome and very boring. When you see it's all futile, it then becomes extremely boring. You have just, oh gosh, this is just, you know, why do I want to continue on with any of this, you know? and people all the world just being like, hey, let's get weird. I say, no, not interested in that. Forget it. Been there, done that. Only causes misery and suffering, which then generates more weirdness. So those who are fortunate enough to be on the path of inquiry, supremely fortunate, because you're able to set this weirdness down and experience true riches. There's no true riches in weirdness at all. At all. Very sad. It's all existence. It's just the Wizard of Oz pulling all these strings. And futile. We keep on hammering at this. We keep on getting familiar with where we're at right now. So that being right where we're at now, seeing this becomes easy. Not a problem. We're very comfortable here. Very comfortable. Final judgment. Only one judgment. There's only one judgment that needs to be made. That's it. Just one. Only one. And that is, all attempts to accomplish impossible are equally futile. First we identify we're trying to accomplish impossible. Trying to be the experiencers of identity. And then we also then, in order to do that, we have to have this wishful thinking, this belief, this faith, blind faith that there's some power, some ability, some capacity to do this. We don't have it now, but we'll find it in the future. We have to believe that in order to maintain this, entertain this idea of being prime creator. In order to entertain the idea of being the experiencer of identity, we have to believe there is some capability, some power in the future that will be activated somehow and will enable us to do this. We have to believe it. It's as simple as that. And then we realize the facts are there is no such power. We cannot be the experiencer of identity. First, you know, we realize both of that. We cannot be the experiencer of identity. Therefore, there is no power. Just blind faith in this. So, everything we're doing is an attempt to activate this power. And it's all equally futile. One judgment. None of this weirdness will ever work at all. It's all zero. So, you see, it's all so simple. You get inquiry is getting to this point of simplicity. Where the whole, all of existence is dismissed with one judgment. Final judgment. Completely simple. And we're simply allowing this realization to sink in. Like, wow, this is what we have to do, and we can do it. And of course, as we do this, we won't be appealing to this non-existent power / God. Identity is God. There is true God, prime creator. It's identity. And so we're trying to be greater than that. We're trying to be the experiencer of identity. Something other than identity, experiencing identity. And so we have to pray to a non-existent God to enable us to accomplish this. Very simple, right? And you're probably saying, ah, my gosh, I'm seeing it. All these efforts, we've been praying to God, as that a non-existent God that we've been praying to, for the most part, that we have blind faith in will enable us to accomplish the impossible and be that which outside, something other than identity, experiencing identity. That is our goal. And we believe that there must be some ability to do that, and this God has the ability and will bestow it upon us if we just evolve enough. We keep thinking we haven't evolved enough. So we believe we're in some kind of spiritual path, some type of path of spiritual growth and evolution, and that the reason why we haven't experienced what we want is we haven't finished the path yet. We have to evolve more. We have to get in tune with the power. We have to get in tune with the God who has this power. You know, we have to. So everybody's just, if you look at all the spiritual stuff that's going on in the world, go to a spiritual retreat, there's all this bizarre stuff going on. You look at it and say, oh my gosh, I just went down the rabbit hole. You know, I'm Alice in Wonderland and I'm at the Mad Hatter's Tea Party right now. I mean, what is all this stuff? Literally, I look at that stuff. I looked at a retreat just recently and all the stuff that's going on there, and just, you know, all these workshops and conferences and lectures and teachers and stuff, and holistic this and that, and exercises and asanas and chanting and all. It's like, I just look at it and say, what in the world are they doing? That is so completely bizarre. And they're all earnestly doing it, you know, thinking that it's bringing them closer to Godhead, closer to Source. But I'll tell you what brings you closer to Source is just to look at all this very calmly and clearly and just say, oh my gosh, this is completely weird. Completely bizarre. Totally weird. Just see it that. Say, it's all, okay, it's all completely weird. And why? What are we doing this for? Why are we here, folks? Trying to get closer to this non-existent source that we think has this power for us. We just have to hook up with this power. We have to align with it, you know. We think we're all trying to align, you know, get an alignment with this power. We think, oh, these cosmic movements of the cosmos and the incoming energy and all this stuff is going to enable us to align with this source. And once we align with source, then we will be happy. Just more bizarreness, right? That's all that it is. Identity already is. We are identity. Only identity is. We're already that. We just need to stop trying to be other than that so that we can experience that as if we are something other than that. That's it. Don't need any cosmic alignments to realize that. It's always completely realizable. The futility has always been futile. It's always been 100% futile. Always will be 100% futile. So what do we need any cosmic alignment for to tell us that? It's realization that anyone had in the past is exactly the same as one will have now or in the future is exactly the same. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. And so it's all zero. It's all nothing. There is no mysterious gods, prime, there is no source that has this power for us, that's going to give us this power. There is none. We've been appealing to nothing. And at first we're kind of upset about this, like, wow, I've been really stupid, you know. Yeah, so we all go through this. I've gone through it. I am going through it. You're going through it. You have been going through it. It's disillusionment, like, oh my gosh, you mean all the song and dance that I've been doing is simply to based on blind faith, but there's someone paying attention to the song and dance? You think, oh my gosh, that's just crazy. I've been crazy. That's stupid. What a fool I've been, you know. And so there's this, initially there's kind of a hurtness and upset. And feeling like, wow, that's just, I don't want to think about that, it's just horrible. But it lightens up to the point where it's very amusing. You can chuckle about it, have a good laugh about it. It does get to that point, you know, but you will go through depressions. You will, like I went through a depression today, after yesterday, realizing that anything other than identity abiding in itself is egoic, is an attempt to activate this power. Anything other than that is an attempt to activate this non-existent power. And I got, you know, went through depression today. Like, I forgot to laugh about it. You know, so of course, you're going to go through episodes of depression. You're going to be miffed. You're going to be upset and say, oh my gosh, what an idiot I've been, you know. Completely, I've been acting like a mad person. Of course, but it's not that, okay? It's not that. It's that you simply are just trying anything and everything. You're intentionally being insane. It's not like you are insane. You are not insane. You're simply acting because nothing else has worked, and you just, you know, think, what the heck, I gotta try something. And all this stuff hasn't worked. Let me just throw this complete weird configuration together. Let me just get into this or get into that. Let me eat, you know, 10 ghost chilies. Maybe that'll do it. Not really. I'm looking at people on YouTube, you know. Some of these channels, maybe you've seen them. I mean, it's just totally, the stuff they do is like incredibly weird. Just, right? Let me eat three rolls of toilet paper. Let me just eat anything. Let me just be completely weird. Let me torture myself. Let me eat this 2 million Scoville unit chili that's just going to, you know, blow my innards out. And let me just do it. Why are they doing this? Why is there all this crazy stuff? Why are they? Just look at you. If you want to see bizarre, just look at YouTube. Just surf YouTube. I mean, it is a cornucopia of bazaar. It is a bazaar of bizarreness. The main bazaar, you know. And it's all right there for you. Are these people insane? No, they're not. They're acting insanely, acting in the bizarre way, weird way, yes. But it's simply because, you know, it's like, what else, you know, nothing worked. Why don't I just try this? For lack of something better to do. I forget the French phrase for that. But, you know, it's like, well, what the heck? Let's try this. Let's stuff Mentos in our mouth and drink Coca-Cola or something and see if we can, you know, some jet will blow out our nose or what, you know, let's chug a gallon of milk or eat, you know, 68 hot dogs in 10 minutes or, you know, it's just, if the people think, well, why not? Nothing else has worked. This is just as good as anything else. And so from our perspective, we say, well, look, why shouldn't we keep acting and keep changing how we act and do weird stuff, because nothing, I haven't seen anything work, so maybe this will work, and who knows, just as good as anything else. So we get into this relativism of bizarreness that just, you know, and sometimes I think, let's all conform, let's all be extremely conformist, because being, you know, non-conformist didn't work, so there's times when we become extremely conformist, like the 50s, you know, everybody, let's all wear our Letterman sweaters, and let's our Argyle sweater vests, and let's all get the buzz cuts, and let's all talk like gosh and gee and swell, and let's all you know, dance to doo-wop and just have the hanging dice in our cars and go to drive-ins, and let's all just be part of this little conformist believing in goodness and all this and do this. In the 50s, you know, 50s were very weird, you know, then that didn't work, and then some people said, oh my gosh, let's just all grow our hair down to our knees, take drugs, and just act promiscuous and act crazy and play extremely loud music. Oh my gosh, I mean, I can't remember any time when I didn't have my amplifier turned up to 10. Everybody played on 10, and it just blew our ears out and just shook the window panes. I mean, at times we thought we'd blow the windows out of the room. And let's sing, we're screaming. Let's just scream into the mic. I mean, I was a great screamer on the microphone, you know. Just scream and wail and play this power, you know, power rock. And let's just, you know, play this, you know, complete grunge and crazy stuff. And let's just, you know, be as weird as possible. So did that, you know, that didn't work. And just, it goes on and on and on. And even the normal stuff is completely weird. Like animals, insects, you know, look at insects. It's weird. What the heck are they doing, you know? Ants, you know, why ants? Ants are so ferociously purposeful, aren't they? They seem like they act like they have some profound purpose to them, you know? Yeah. You know, we are colonizing, we are producing, you know, an endless stream of ants, and for what purpose? No purpose at all. None of existence has no purpose to it. But we are frantically purposeful. Like ants are extremely purposeful. Bees, you know, bees. Well, of course, bees are pollinating. You know, but they, you know, they say we must. That's a side product of what they're doing. But they find out we can get this. Nature is using them in that way. But bees are, you know, very purposeful. They think, hey, you know, if I just pollinate all this fruit and make all this honey and keep the hive going, and the fruit will flower and drop and produce more fruit, and other animals eat that fruit, and everything, you know, this will work. So consciousness, the play of consciousness, is simply this: all these attempts to find something that works. You know, first it raises up little, you know, microbes and all this. Or first it raises up the universe, and then forms the stars and the planets and the microbes, and then the simple animals and atmospheres and all this stuff, and just keeps on going and going and going. And none of it works. You know, the fish. What are the fish doing? Fish, schools of fish, they're just swimming. They're eating and they're swimming. What are they doing? Really? Food for other bigger fish. What are the bigger fish doing? Food for other bigger fish. And what are the other bigger fish doing? It's all just a circle of, you know, there is no answer to it. Except when you realize it's all part of the song and dance to get this blind faithfully believed in nothingness, thinking that there's some, this nothingness has some power, that it's actually some God greater than the God of identity. And this God, this invisible God, is going to bestow, release some great power on us if we just align in some way with it and somehow please it in some way. We don't know how, because we've never done it. There's all sorts of theories, endless theories. How do we get this God to release the power? So you got these preachers, you know, and they're all jumping up and down, and the people, audience is screaming. And say, I feel the power, you know, I released the power, release the power, God, release the power on the congregation. And you know, they're all falling down, slayed by the power of the Lord and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, totally weird, right? For some people looking at that, it's completely bizarre. And for other people engaging, it's not weird at all. It's like saying, hey, you know, we're working on releasing the power of the Lord. Yeah, but that Lord isn't there. There is no such power of the Lord like that at all. Identity doesn't need power. It is. It already is. It is life. It's not releasing anything. It is simply expanding and experiencing itself in infinite delight. And so, you know, we weirdness comes in all different varieties. See, I'm not picking on anyone, any style of weirdness. I'm just illustrating, you know, it's all weird. It's all equally weird, really. It's all equally weird. I mean, what are the sheep doing here? You know, really. Really? What are they doing? I mean, you think they're carrying out some, you know, important ecological function, as and then you can say, well, why even have the ecology in the first place? What's the planet doing, really? But the sheep, you know, I mean, if you let them go, they'll strip a hillside. They'll many places like have been overgrazed and turned into barren, you know, barren hills, desert from sheep. So very destructive. But I mean, what are the sheep doing, really? Standing there with all this, you know, what is it, wool growing on them, and just lying down, eat, munch the grass all day. And what are they doing? It's completely weird. And yet, you know, most refuse to see that. They can't tolerate it. They have to say no. They have to find scientific reasons for everything. Everything's happening for some scientific reason. This is all intelligent design. This is all totally purposeful, and every little last thing that's happening is happening exactly because it has to happen exactly that way. And every bite that a sheep takes is somehow profound, and, you know, all this. There is no profundity to existence at all, none. It's the absence of profundity. There's nothing there. We've just put this all together as a mishmash, been working on it for a long time. And we're still working on it. And there's going to be big changes coming up because none of this has worked. So, of course, change is always happening because nothing works. If nothing works, what do you got? You got two options. Either you drop the effort or you change your tactics, right? You got to. Or feel to complete despair. That's your option. So, of course, we keep changing. In fact, we designed this to just generate continuous weirdness, continual efforts, continuous attempts to generate this power. We can, some say we're trying to get this power from God, the others say we're trying to generate this power, working on generating it. So you have two divisions. You have those that believe there is this supreme power that will, if we align with it properly, we will feel the power to experience identity. And others say that no, there is no such supreme power, but actually existence itself is going to produce, if we just keep being good shepherds and stewards of this planet and of existence and evolving, eventually we will evolve this power. We'll grow it. You know, we're gardeners of this, and it's, you know, it's in development. Some say the power is already perfectly there and it's just we need to find a way to release it. Those are the more religious people, you might say they're just trying to appeal to God and pray to God to get this power released for us. They think if we just get God to release it, one person can save the whole world. Because if just one person goes to God and gets God to release the power, then the power, once the power is released, we'll all be saved. You know, that we'll all experiences of identity. So that's the idea of the Savior. That just need one person to do it, and what people believe in. There's the Savior that's done this. You know, somehow figured out a way to do it. Maybe the death of a Savior will please God so much that God's like, oh my gosh, you finally did what I wanted you to do, so now I'm going to release this power for you, you know. And the others don't believe that there's this non-existent power already perfectly there for us. They think that we have to develop the power. So they're gradually working on building up, you know, advancing better education, better society, better civilizations, being more loving, and going through all this stuff, thinking, you know, we are eventually going to build up this capability. Yeah. Those are the facts. And I know it strikes you, at first it strikes you like, wow, yeah. And then you get kind of upset and depressed, like, oh my gosh, I've been engaged in this ridiculous charade for so long. And then later you get back to it and you say, oh, it's not so bad. I don't feel so bad about that. That's I kind of see, you know, why. Because I wanted to try and be prime creator. And since nothing works, I had to simply believe that somehow I could accomplish this. You know, otherwise I would have dropped the idea right away. So I basically have to believe either there's some God with the power that's already there, or I have to try to develop the power. One of the two, or it's just going to come about luck out of luck. You know, just for no reason at all. There are those who also. That's another, you know, the other main division of people here. A belief is that it somehow nobody knows how or nobody knows why. It'll just be there. No God and no working towards it. It'll just be there. There's that also belief. So these various different beliefs, you know, clash with one another. The people that believe that God, the power's already there, and we just need to get God to release it. And maybe if we sacrifice something, it'll cause God to release it. There's that belief. There's the belief that we know it isn't there yet, but it's up to us to build it up. We can build it up, and then the belief that it will just happen. Nobody knows how or why it happens. Will happen. It'll just happen for us. Not that we built it up, or not that there's some God releasing it to us. Nobody knows. It's unknowable. It'll just happen. So there you go. You know, those three basics, and then blends of all those three basics. All of it, you know, completely ridiculous. We can't build the power. There isn't any power. It'll never happen. No such power ever happened. Only identity is. There's only identity. That's it. Nothing outside of identity. Identity is omnipresent. That's all it is. It's always been the case. It's not possible for there to be anything outside of it to experience it as an experience. It doesn't matter what our beliefs are. Okay, well, so far this is recorded, so maybe I'm going to try and I'm not going to press my luck too much, and I'm just going to get this up here because this has been another really, really wonderful satsang for me to be part of, because it's always fabulous, great to speak the truth and to share it with the world, because it's a very, very uncommon thing, extremely uncommon. To talk this way, it just doesn't happen here. just because it seems like you're stepping on everyone's toes. But I'm not really doing that at all. That's not the purpose. And, you know, I hope that people get that. So even though they may get depressed for a little while, they bounce back and say, okay, I understand. It's not mean-spirited. It's not trying to step on anyone's toes or say anyone's worse than anyone else. I'm saying it's all equally futile, you know. And you know, we can notice things that's more obviously bizarre, whatever. That's only for the point of pointing out the situation and being clear about it, so that we can drop this whole effort to be prime creator. Got to see the folly of it. Got to see just the profound folly of it, and realize only one judgment we need to make. So we keep at this. We keep at it. We keep at it. We keep at it. We keep at it. Don't worry if you don't get it right now, because actually, you know, you'll get it, and you'll feel like, wow, kind of hurt by it. You know, kind of hurt by it, kind of upset by it. It's tough, like, but you'll bounce back from it. Bounce back and get a little chuckle, and then look at it again. It's not so bad. Every time you look at it, it's not as bad. Every time, it's not as bad. You go a little deeper, a little deeper, a little deeper. It's like coming up from the depths of the ocean. You got to decompress. Come up a bit at a time, bit at a time, bit at a time, bit at a time. Don't try to come up too fast, but keep coming up. And it's a vast relief to hear this and to realize that you're not alone. You know, there's a lot of people out there I know who want to drop this whole ridiculous charade. But they feel like, oh my gosh, nobody else is doing it. I'll be all alone. And it's too tough to do that all alone. And so this is helpful. You know, you realize, no, you're not all alone. Everybody is going through this. They're gradually realizing this is all futile, you know. And as they're gradually realizing, a lot of them are act out and say, oh my gosh, it's all futile. I better try something really bizarre, you know. So sometimes you might even, on the path to realizing it's all futile, you may act out in bizarre ways. Get weird at times, sure, you know, but the important thing is you recognize and say, whoa, wait a minute, whoa, you know, I'm trying to get weird here. Why am I trying to get weird? What good is weirdness going to do? You know, it's all futile. Stop, I don't need to be really weird here. Let's go back to inquiry. Just do that, and know you're not alone, you know, not alone in that whatsoever. Okay, very great, that's it. Let's see if I can get this up on YouTube.